former friend of mine had ChatGPT translate a Shakespearean essay into how a teenage girl would explain it to her group chat. It kind of felt like in that moment we had strayed so far from God. It felt like a punch to the gut for human innovation.
Someone once said to me, like, writing is just thinking on paper. And I think that it's really dangerous that if you have AI doing the writing for you, then you basically have AI doing the thinking for you. You'll lose some of your agency in the classroom if you let AI take that away from you.
When's the last time you felt that people have really listened to one another, the way we just listen to those voices? If you're struggling to think of an example, you're not alone. I've spent the last 3 decades at MIT studying how people communicate, from child language development in families to global social media platforms. In the past, when I was Twitter's chief media scientist, I had a front row seat at watching how social media evolved. And then when I left Twitter and came back to MIT, my team revealed some startling and really disturbing patterns of social media: large-scale social fragmentation, viral spread of false news. When you give people a bullhorn, some learn how to use it effectively. The result is social fragmentation. A lot of the voices that tend to get the most viral spread are the most extreme positions, often the most emotionally provocative, leaving no room for nuance. The same patterns have spilled into our in-person meeting spaces. So I believe that hearing the humanity in others is necessary for our communities to function. It's necessary for our democracies to function. We need something better than the options we have today. So what if we could create a new kind of communication space, a network that is optimized for listening, for understanding? The voices you just heard are the result of such a system that my colleagues at the MIT Center for Constructive Communication almost a decade ago started researching. And then we created a nonprofit called Cortico to translate some of that research into practice. We've worked with hundreds of organizations, mainly around the United States, to test and iterate this method that focuses on real listening rather than performance. And it works. And I'm here to say that it's ready to scale. So what I'd like to do today is explain to you how the process works and then end with an ask for all of you. So we begin by having quiet spaces where a person, a host, can invite people from their networks of trust to create small groups in what we call circles of trust. 4 to 6 people is ideal. They use a structured conversation guide that encourages people to share personal experiences or stories, which, with consent, are recorded and transcribed. So this is step one, to talk, not as individuals, not in large, unmoderated spaces, but in small groups that are facilitated. It can happen in person, it can happen over Zoom, as long as it's a live, small group that is hearing each other's voices. Once you have a number of these conversations with shared prompts, step two is to understand the themes or the narratives or the patterns that emerge across these small group conversations. We've created AI tools that are under the control of people in the community to do this interpretive step. Those are converted into voice outputs like medleys and conversation maps, and that takes us to step three, to share. Share those outputs back with all the groups that participated so that they can see and discover the connections across those groups. And with consent, we can also create public media outputs and actionable insights to shape public understanding and to shape public policy. So the voices you heard came from a project we started over the summer with FRONTLINE, the documentary filmmaker. Together, we brought together a group of college and high school students who learned how to develop a conversation campaign about how AI was starting to impact them and their peers' lives. And the idea was for this young group to learn this talk, understand, share process and lift up voices of their peers, which, among other things, will actually lead to shaping a documentary about AI that FRONTLINE is currently working on. So let's listen
because
to some voices.
You know, so many capable people that are creative and capable of, you know, deep intellectual, you know, capabilities, but choose not to for convenience.
And I feel like when it comes to AI, it could help you either harness discipline or it could just completely get rid of that. It's either one or the other.
What ability am I okay kind of giving to AI? And what abilities do I kind of want to retain for myself? I think that's going to get harder and harder as time goes on.
It's alarming to see industries that you've looked up to your whole life be replaced by like one generative program.
Yes, AI is advancing, but that doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to do more harm than good. I think that overall, AI doesn't necessarily have to be this big, bad, evil.
If I like am tough on time, I'll like put in my notes and say like, write this in my style and it'll make little things. And then I do that sometimes and then I feel bad about it. I mean, I still turn it in, but it like doesn't feel right to me.
I'd say it's really all about being intentional in what exactly we are relegating to AI.
So that's an example of a voice medley that came out of what this young group of students facilitated with their peers. The process, just to unpack it, first they learned how to make a conversation guide. They used that guide to structure conversations with peers. They reached out to friends, to peers. Some of these conversations happen in person, some over Zoom. Then they upload the transcription into this tool built by the nonprofit Cortico and highlight portions of those conversations. What you're seeing here is a highlighting of that very first voice you heard. And then there's a workspace where they can create what's called a code book, themes and sub-themes that show up over multiple highlights. And each of these themes, the sense-making team will create a definition. So here you see the definition for over-reliance. And then we can take each highlight and ask an AI to figure out which themes and sub-themes apply to this highlight. So the AI is assisting, but it's actually that group of young people who decide which tags should apply to each highlight. Once the tagging is done, there's another way that you can see the comprehensive picture of what occurred across all the conversations, what we call a conversation map. So this is actually now a live website where we can see themes and we can dig into themes and see sub-themes that emerge across all the conversations and also see a visual map of all the conversations and where the themes show up and where they intersect as a way to create this interactive map where you can situate every piece of audio that we heard in that medley. So this creates a transparent and comprehensive complement to the voice medley. So this approach has been used by high school students in public schools in Maine to have student-led conversations that have led to policy changes in schools. We are currently working with the New York City Planning Department to surface community experiences of people who live near the Cross Bronx Expressway, and the patterns that emerge from that are being used to inform a replanning of the area. We work with NPR, where journalists from across the country learned how to use this approach and have community conversations, which were then pooled using the power of the platform to actually find themes across communities across the country. And that turned into a set of nationally broadcast stories on NPR. So zooming out, over 300 partner organizations have used this listening approach to drive meaningful social impact in a variety of ways across the country. The underlying model is not a social media network that drives viral change. Instead, these small groups that are hosted with prompts designed by people in the community lead to resonant patterns that sense makers lift up, interpret, curators turn into voice medleys that create these kinds of media outputs. We've developed training guides and AI tools to support people in communities that have no specific expertise to take on all these roles. A key for us is that this builds agency for people in communities to shape the communication spaces that they feel they need. So it's a decentralized approach where AI is not trying to replace people, but support them, serve as scaffolding to build these skills. These networks can be connected together naturally. That's what happened with NPR to create scalable networks. Another example of a large-scale effort that was announced just a month ago is the American Conversation Project. The National Conference on Citizenship is leading this effort. They're bringing together a group of national civic organizations, including Citizens and Scholars, Braver Angels, and many others. Their vision is to have thousands of conversations with Americans across the country over the next year, with questions that will go into the conversation prompts, such as, what does America mean to you? What do you hope it can become? What's something you can do where you live to help make that real? Imagine thousands or even tens of thousands of Americans in every state in small groups speaking authentically to people they know and trust and allowing those voices to bubble up and for us to see the connections that emerge. I do believe, as we often see, that we'll discover we have more in common than media and social media environment often leads us to believe. So whether it's conversations about America or conversations about AI, we envision this new kind of conversation space that can reveal connections across our lives, across the country and beyond. I'm going to play one more medley. These are how people in these small group conversations are impacted in the moment from the kind of rich conversations that emerge.
Only when people feel understood can they understand others. I think it's really cool that stories provide opportunities for us to problem solve.
I have learned that a lot of people are coming with so much wisdom, and that when we just create the space, there's a lot of emergence that's really valuable and a lot of compassion that can lead somewhere that's constructive.
We gotta respect that the people in the communities know what they want and need, and that they may not have the education and certifications, but they know their community.
We can self-determine and self-organize and say who we are because we are connected and we know what we want.
I think we have to remember that we should stop thinking as individuals and work as teams and collectives, and that we can be way more powerful that way.
In some way, that makes you feel a little bit less alone and insular, and you feel a bit more engaged with other people's thoughts, and there's not actually a lot of disparity, which is quite comforting.
I am now imagining that we would see network of people that are collaborating with each other, inspiring each other, sharing with each other in order to break the boundaries and reduce inequalities.
Humanity is what's at stake. Hopefully our voices collectively can continue to do that ripple effect.
So this is where I come to my ask of all of you, which is to join the conversation. So there's three ways that I'm able to invite you in to be part of this. One, you can learn about the approach, and we can support you in bringing this approach to your community if you want to start a conversation project about a topic you care about. Two, you can host a conversation about AI. The conversation guide that was created by those young people has been evolved, and you can download it, gather a small group of neighbors, of friends, of family, and have a conversation about how AI is impacting your lives, and then upload the recording. If you want, you can keep the names anonymous, and then your voices will get connected to all the other voices. There's many more people now having conversations about AI using this platform, and you'll see connections, including to the voices you heard in my talk today. And third, if you're interested, you can join the American Conversation Project. That is going to be launching soon, and you can sign up and find a way to get involved. So if you are concerned about the health of our communities, if you're concerned about the health of democracy, if you feel that we need better ways to listen to one another across divides, there is something you can do. You can join us, and I hope you will. Thank you very much.